You would not believe how long it took for me to save up to buy this thing. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's your friend and host, Zora, aka The Other Apprentice here, and welcome to today's video where we will be building and taking a look at the LEGO Disney Railroad playset. Now, I'm sure many of you, myself included, expected me to be one of the first people to get my hands on this set, but 2 years and one strenuous Christmas job later, I finally had enough money to buy this set. And I am so very glad to do so because look at this. It's gorgeous. Are you seeing this? It's wonderful. And anyone who knows me knows that I love trains. That's one thing that Walt and I share in common, is that we have an affinity for locomotives. Now, I'm sure one of the main attractions to this set for me personally is the fact that we have an exclusive Goofy minifigure at long, long last, but, I mean, hey, the rest of it looks pretty darn good too. Now, looking at the back of this very big box, you can see that the reference photos that they have provided here make a note that this is clearly based on the Disneyland Railroad, and I don't know why they don't specify that. But, in fairness, since the last set with the Disney Castle was based on Cinderella Castle in Magic Kingdom and Walt Disney World, it is nice that we do have a structure that is based in the original park, Disneyland. And of course I've done my fair amount of research on this thing, but I still don't quite know how the app is going to power up this here train. But there's only one way to get all of our questions answered, and that is to build it. Come on, let's get down to the building table. Now, if I could make an educated guess here, at least based on the amount of pieces we've got and this lovely promotional work on the box, I'm going to assume that this build is probably going to be somewhat slightly repetitive, at least when it comes to the facade on the station itself. But that's okay, because if we've learned anything from the castle build, it's that repetition is our friend, especially when it comes to gorgeous details like these, because they are what makes sets like these distinctly Disney. So, let's open up these boxes and bags and see what we're up against here. Eee, this is so exciting, opening this up for the first time. Okay. Savoring the moment. And moment savored. Okay, let's get this open and timber! Whoa! Wow! Look at that. What is this? It's big. It's gorgeous. What is it? Oh, I see. Oh. Oh, so I see. That's very interesting. So the station comes in its own separate little box. Cool. And now I just confused myself as to which one is which. Oh boy. Well, no matter. I mean, hey, we're not here to look at boxes and bags. Let's get this baby built. Let the magic begin. With this fully operational set, the magic will really come to life as the train is powered up by the LEGO Powered Up Hub. Cool. We've got four instruction books, three sets of gorgeous stickers, and 18 bags of constructible goodness. How amazing is that? Well, this certainly promises to be fun. And to round out the occasion, I am not only wearing my Disney train t-shirt from before, but I have also equipped my phone case with a little goofy chubby, and I am just ready to finally have this in my possession. All these years of saving up, and it all comes down to this. But enough with the jibber jabber, let's get to the build. Next stop, Disneyland Station, board! Thank you. here we are with the fully built and completed Lego train and station. Doesn't it look gorgeous? I gotta tell you, I knew that it would be flabbergasting to see the whole thing built in one piece, but wow, just wow, the detail is just, it's astounding, isn't it? Now, of course, before we get on to the main build itself, let's take a look at those minifigures, shall we? First up, we have the main mouse himself, Mickey, looking adorable in this exclusive train engineer's outfit. He's got some black shoes, blue overalls, and this cute little red necktie that he's got to top off the whole outfit. And then coming around the back, you can see that it's nicely tied with two big yellow buttons on the suspenders part there. Overall, he's not too different from the other Mickey Mouse figures that we've seen. The face is still the same, but the outfit, really quite nice. I only wish that he came with a hat, but, you know, I guess you could take one of your spare Steamboat Willie hats and plop it on right there, since he's got the same little hole in his head. But overall, I really like this one. It's different, it's cute, although I think some white stripes would really tie the look together, but that's just me. Next up, we have Minnie Mouse looking absolutely fabulous in this familiar yet still new outfit that we have exclusive to this set. Eagle-eyed viewers will probably notice that this variant is quite different to the one that we had in the LEGO Disney Castle set. Of course, you can still see that she's in her familiar red and white polka dot outfit, but there are a few key differences. For one thing, there are no polka dots on her torso except for on the puffy sleeve here. I like that. We didn't have that before, so I'm glad they added that back in now. But I do find it a little odd that they change up the collar and the outfit, but they don't add in any more polka dots just to give it just a little bit more pop. So I do think that's a bit of a missed opportunity, but she still looks nice. Another thing that's most obvious is that her dress is now a cloth skirt piece as opposed to a molded one. And I gotta be honest, I don't know how I feel about that. Yes, while it's true that with the original skirt piece, it's very difficult for her to get some mobility in her legs, not to mention she can barely even sit down without her torso coming loose. But at the same time, though, while I do like the cloth and the pattern and everything, it blends in very well, if you have her arms raised, it looks like you've got a little bit of some Marilyn Monroe action going on here, and, well, you know, I'm just glad that they changed her legs from bloomers to shorts of some sort. But that is interesting. I'm glad that we'll be able to actually have her sit down now, but I don't know if it's as practical. Plus, I mean, with so many pre-existing versions of Minnie, it just seems a little late in the game to be changing that now, but I do appreciate that it does look good. I just don't know whether or not in an attempt to be more practical if it becomes even less so. But she still looks great, and I do love that she has some new details that we haven't seen before. Next up, we have Chip and Dale looking very smartly dressed in their conductor's uniforms. I don't know who thought it would be a good idea to put these two pranksters in such positions of power, but hey, they both look rather dashing. Starting off with Chip, he's going for the full uniformed look with a matching dark blue coat and pants combo with a nice blue tie and gold chain across the torso. On the back, there isn't much as far as printing goes, but you can see a slight part down here as if to simulate coattails. Very nice. As for Dale, he is going for the vest look, so you have a nice set of white sleeves poking out of the same matching dark blue vest and pants combo with the same tie, buttons, and gold-chained watch in the pocket. His back printing is actually a little nicer. You can see the tied buckle right there. And overall, I think it's nice that they included these two again, since the last time we saw them was in the second series of Disney minifigure sets. And I don't know, I'm glad that they're making more regular uses out of these characters, and looking pretty darn snappy to boot. Last but certainly not least, we have the exclusive minifigure to this set, Goofy. And I am so glad that we do finally have an official Goofy minifigure. Look at this, isn't it fantastic? I love this sculpt on the head. I think he's quite possibly the best sculpt that we've gotten so far. I do have to say, though, I think it is a bit bizarre seeing such wonderful proportions on such a normal-sized minifigure. I mean, I do think it would have been just a little bit nicer if we could have gotten him a bit taller like we did with the old Woody minifigure, like we had back in 2010's Toy Story sets, but nevertheless, the printing still looks great, with the yellow vest on the orange shirt, very nice, even around on the back printing here. And look, we've even got a little orange patch on the pants, that's great. Bottomed off with the shoes and the hat, sans black stripe. I'm actually kind of disappointed that this isn't removable or adjustable, but on the other hand, I guess it's a good thing that it isn't, just because, I don't know, maybe people have lost a lot of Minnie's hats and bows, but still, he looks great. I am so happy to finally have him. Welcome, Goofy. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Gosh, I'm just happy to be here.
Right then, now that we've covered those marvelous minifigures, let's take a closer look at that train. Now, I'm going to be dissecting the train car by car, but hopefully we can still get through this in pretty good time. First and foremost, we will be starting with, naturally, the CK Holiday locomotive. Now, despite this looking and building like your typical average LEGO locomotive, I'm still very impressed at how true the details are to the real thing. Everything right down from the color scheme to the shape of the smokestack, which is probably what I'm most impressed with. But what I really love is that the playability factor has been upped for this set. The last train that I had was from the LEGO Lone Ranger sets back in 2013, and as much as I love the Jupiter's cab, it still feels slightly cramped somehow. This, however, has a whole bunch of bells and whistles to the build, no pun intended. If you open up the flap here, which I already love, you can see that there's this designated standing space for one minifigure. Just put Mickey in there for now, if I can. Hard to look through the camera. There we go. Oh, well, I mean, he's having a little nap now, so that's fine. But I do also appreciate that there is a nice hinged door to the simulated firebox. You can't actually open it, which is a bummer, but hey, it's still a nice facade detail that I appreciate. But everything, right down from the actual bell to the domes, and even to these parts right here, it's really quite incredible at how well this whole thing was recreated. You know, you've got the lantern and the number one here. That being said, however, I do have a few things that I myself would personally change. Number one, since this is clearly supposed to be based on the CK Holiday, I don't know why it doesn't have CK Holiday along the side, but, you know, I guess that's just LEGO's love for genericism. I hate to be picky, but if you've ever seen an actual Disney locomotive up close, you would know that the steam boxes here have a nice glossy chrome finish, and I think that would have really topped this whole thing off. Like I said, the color scheme is pretty down pat, and especially when you have the nice bronze pieces here, I think a little bit more shine on these stickers would have been good, but yeah, definitely a lot more shimmer and shine on this area would be much appreciated. Again, it's a very, very impressive recreation, so well done to everyone who had a hand in designing this, because I'm quite blown away. Next up, we have the tender box, or coal car, and yes, this is the one that provides all of the power to the fully functioning moving train set. I don't really have too much to say about this, except I absolutely love how well this was recreated, especially when it comes to the font and the signage. I'm not too great with stickers, as you can probably tell, but considering that the R is split right down the middle, I think I placed it fairly okay. What's more, I'm incredibly impressed as to how well this car hides the 6 AAA battery pack that is secluded within this coal car. That is truly impressive. I know that this is something that they've been doing for a while now, but it's just so well done, apart from the wires and the plugs sticking out there. But other than that, it's practical, it's cool, it's very well designed, so yeah, major points on that one. Next up is the gondola passenger car, and this might just be my favorite part of the whole train build. Not only just because it's so distinctly Disney in its look, and its color scheme, and its design, but it makes me feel so nostalgic for when I was riding around in these exact same cars touring around Disneyland. And if even a small part of something can make you feel anything, that is a good sign of a great recreation. Now, remember when I said that the playability factor has been upped? Well, I think one of my favorite parts about this, whoop, the roofs flap up. Not only do you have an amazing attention to detail with the overhangs here, but true to the original, all of the seats face one way so that Disneyland guests can see the whole kingdom without any bad angles. Now, there are 7 seats on each side,
But unfortunately, not every minifigure can sit side by side. But you can still get a lot of figures in here, which I love. Of course, this area here stays where it is, and I think that's a really good idea. Again, I think we could have probably had just a few more standing studs in the middle here, just so that Chip or whoever you have isn't stuck here. But, I mean, hey, the stairs are a really nice touch. They didn't have to include that, but they did, and it was very smart the way that they did. So, you know, bravo, honestly. That is just... This whole car might just very well have been my favorite part of the build. So, bravo. Ending off the train, we have this gorgeous presidential parlor car acting as the caboose. But if you are a true Disney-phile like myself, you would know that this is clearly supposed to be the Lily Bell, named, of course, after Walt Disney's wife. But again, I really wish that they had included that in the plates here, but I guess details like that are meant for the instruction booklets, which they also neglected to mention there, which is really disappointing now that I think about it. Speaking of names, I really like that they have, you know, Disney Railroad plastered all over it, but did they really have to be stickers? I know there are some people that are awesome at placement and good for you, but for uncoordinated people like me, well, let's just say I spent a fair amount of time trying to get these look even halfway straight. But, you know, they look gorgeous, they're wonderful accents, and even the little 106 here, really nice touches. And you've even got a nice little sticker on the back with, again, another Disney sticker. So, hey, well, that's really nice. With the rails and lanterns and doors here on the outside, that really looks gorgeous when you have it all together with these nice ridge pieces combined with the windows and the flat red ones. Now, another final bit of playability that has been upped. Instead of accessing the interior by pulling off the roof and having some pieces missing, instead, this one allows you to take off... Ta-da! One of the walls. I actually love that so much better. Inside, you can see some luxurious chairs here with some tea sets and all this filigree, and it's gorgeous and lovely. Now, the real Lily Bell has a lot more room in it, and again, we've lost some of that with these sleek plate parts here, but, you know, as far as trying to recreate the aesthetic goes, I knew exactly what it was, so I really have to commend whoever designed this, because this is really well done. Despite the small scale, they did what they could as far as details go in the interior, so I certainly cannot complain there. I think if Walt were to see this train, I think he would approve. Of course, you know, if they actually kept the names. But other than that, but that is the train in its stationary state. So why don't we put those wheels in motion, and I'll show you how it works.
To power on your LEGO Disney train,
what you want to do is lift this flap here, hold down the green button for about 10 seconds, and then once that's all synced up with the Bluetooth and the LEGO Power Up app, you'll have two options, regular and seasonal. First, let's start off the regular. And we have this very crude map of a Disneyland type park. Again, very generic and not quite too Disney-esque, but enough that Disney-philes will recognize, oh, that's supposed to be Haunted Mansion, that's supposed to be Space Mountain, etc., etc. But we're not here to judge the art. Let's just start up the train. And that is on the slowest function. You can hear that the chugs coincide with the speed of the train. Let's go a little bit faster. One more. Here we go, and full speed ahead. And I think that's as fast as it goes. As you can see, we're really picking up speed now. We've got some sound effects, a bell, and a whistle. We even have some painfully generic sounding Disney music. It's a nice touch. It's harmless enough. I appreciate that they at least included that in there. It's not really authentic, but it's cute. It's got the right kind of
mood there.
Now, of course, that is on a loop. Now, once you exit that setting, the train will come to a complete stop, and it's the same thing if you exit out of the app. So, yeah, you won't be able to take a video while the thing is going. Sorry. But let's quickly check out the winter setting. It's pretty much the same, except the music is different. Again, very generic, but Disney-sounding enough. And the artwork of the map is all covered in snow. Isn't that nice? It's pretty much the same as far as the settings go. Bell and whistle, again, no change there. But it's nice. And when you put to a stop, that I do like. And if you want to slow down even when it's at the slowest setting, there we go, screeches to a halt. Nice, very nice. Basic, straightforward. Easy to control, but there's just something about this map that kind of hits a sour note with me, but we'll get to that in just a little bit. The main build itself is gorgeous. I can't get over how good it looks, but as I predicted, it was a very, very repetitive one. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. Like I said, the Disney is distinctly in the details. What you'll probably find if you're building this set is that the gray brickwork along the corners is probably what's going to take up most of your time. Not to mention all of the black framework around here. Ooh, that was quite extensive, but worth it. I really do love the color they chose for the brickwork along the walls. I think it complements the roof rims very nicely. As far as the actual roof itself goes, I don't know if I would have gone with this particular color. It looks very nice composition-wise as a Lego set, but in comparison to the original, I don't know. It just looks a little too dark for me, but it does add a nice splash of color, so I do appreciate that much. Speaking of appreciation, I absolutely adore the amount of attention that was given to the structure decorations, especially along these lines. The lights look terrific, and the roofing, I've never seen any kind of windowsill like that before, so, I mean, that is amazing. Speaking of appearances, you'll probably notice that we've got some more sticker parts, here, here, and here, along the flags, naturally. Again, I wish those had been printed, but hey, they still look really nice, and not to toot my own horn, but I don't think I did too bad of a job, so hey, maybe this is good practice. I do wish we could have gotten some double doors like the actual structure has, but then you'd probably have to make it a little bit bigger, and hey, bigger's better, but probably just a little bit more expensive, but we'll get to the price a little bit later. But yes, I do love the facade on the outside. You can see that they did not get lazy even when it came to the sides here. And yeah, even in profile, it just has such a marvelous look. Look at that! That is gorgeous. And then on the clock tower here, you'll notice that it is the same time as we had on the Disney castle, which is at 11:53. I do love that they are in sync. That is wonderful and a very nice touch. Let's take a look inside. Now, clearly, as this is a Lego playset, they probably had to take some creative liberties. I'm sure the downstairs looks fairly accurate, but the upstairs, I've never really been upstairs, so I can't really say. But I do, nevertheless, like the amount of detail that we've got going on here. Coming through the front door here on the ground floor, we have a nice ticket counter over here, complete with teacups, floral sets, what I presume are supposed to be tickets, and a sticker time sheet. Over here we have a nice little bench. Very fun build, a bit unconventional, but hey, it looks great. Then over on the back next to this door we have an umbrella stand, complete with some hanged photos of a black and white train and the monorail system. Then just up here we have a nice crystal chandelier, very cool. And over on this wall next to this door we have some more sticker pieces with some clocks, posters, and the like. And just over here, we have your classic Disney garbage can. I love it. It's even got the insignia. It's now that is a nice touch. That is one sticker I did not mind applying. One thing I really like about the interiors of this set is that it includes little miniature Lego models of the trains that go throughout the Disney parks with the accompanying photos on the walls behind them. I think that's really nice. I think that's really neat. We have this one down here and this one up here. And we have a glass door that goes out to the balcony and a nice potted plant. Really ties the room together, don't you think? Then we go down this hallway, and I really like what they did with the curtains, with the rails and everything like that. Very nice details. And then, of course, we've got some boards with some important information tacked on there. And this lovely, lovely rug. Look at that. Again, I wish those were printed pieces, but, you know, when you've got stickers with that kind of design, you can't be mad. Then we head on over up here, up these stairs, which were also a really nice build. And we have a nice little tea nook over here with another one of those fancy presidential chairs and another teacup. Isn't that cute? And finally, up here in this attic section, we have a miniature model build of the Lego Disney castle, complete with a printed piece recreating the original box. Now that is a really nice detail. They didn't have to do that, but they did. And I think it's all the better for it. I mean, look at this. Even though it's supposed to be a tiny model, they did not spare any expense on the details when it came to the castle and the little miniature trains here. That, I really appreciate. But now let's address a detail that I want to like, but can't. You see this simulated photo behind the counter? Yeah. That is clearly supposed to be a recreation of one of Walt Disney's most famous photos. Don't believe me? Take a look here. Yeah. But the minifigure they've got in that picture doesn't look a thing like Walt. They didn't even try to make it look like him. It's the same thing here with this would-be Disneyland map. Oh, sure, they've got a placeholder partner statue, but I can't even tell if that's supposed to be Mickey. So why wouldn't they include Walt? Is it because they didn't have the rights? Is it some other stupid reason I don't want to get into right now? I don't know, but the fact that they even had this idea and didn't go all the way with it, it really, really makes me mad. Like, without Mr. Disney, we wouldn't even have all this. So, I'm sorry, but I'm gonna have to dock some serious points for that one, because that's just... No, I'm sorry, that's just unacceptable. But out of all the pieces in this entire building, these ones are probably gonna be the ones that need to be replaced first. And, I mean, if you're used to that, then great, but... I don't know. I'd just be very, very careful with these pieces. Maybe that's just me being paranoid, but just, you can never be too careful, you know? On the positive side, though, I do really like these flags. It's just, they're simple, they're basic, but for my purposes, they're perfect. And this is going to be an excellent entrance to my kingdom. Overall, despite my criticisms, I do think this is a really great set. Whether you're a casual Disney fan or a hardcore one like myself, you can't deny that this is a perfect partner set to go along with the castle. The train itself will provide endless hours of entertainment, and I'm sure that whatever people come up with for scenarios inside the station are sure to be adorable. Of course, there are some things about this that I would personally change. Maybe make it a little bit bigger so we can get those classic double doors back. Maybe either change the color of the roof or adjust the bricks to a little bit more of a brighter red just so that we can have that nice contrast. Add some stud space on the train and in the station itself. And whoever's idea it was to deliberately exclude Walt from his representation, I hope you get fired. But other than that, it's a wonderful set. I recommend this highly at a strong 4 out of 5. I am taking away that 5 due to the not Walt in the office. Now, at the price I got this for, which was about 275 Canadian, I'd say that's a pretty fair price. Not only are you getting this gorgeous facade and the train, but you are also getting a train that works, and you're paying the technology that comes with it. But if only the batteries would come included, that would be nice. Plus, come on, you're getting Goofy with this set. Goofy! I mean, come on. He's worth the 300 bucks, right? Right?
But there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Those are my thoughts on the Lego Disney train and station set. What did you think? Is there something about this set that you love or maybe don't love? Let me know down in the comments below, and I'd love to hear what you think. But for now though, thank you so very much for watching this video. I do hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, then please be sure to leave a like, comment, and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. Be sure to keep a weather eye on the horizon for more sights, sounds, and surprises from yours truly. And until next time, I am Zora Katone, the Other Apprentice, and I'll be seeing you real soon. Come to think of it, I kind of wish that they included the hill with the Mickey topiary and the archways on the sides. I guess I'm gonna have to do that myself, huh?